Hello and welcome to this lecture on lattice Boltzmann method. So today I'll just resume from first of all where we left off in the last lecture. So we were looking at the calculation of force, which is experienced by the fluid as a result of reflection or as a result of momentum exchange from a solid. So what we had looked at in the last lecture was that if there is a moving wall, okay, and if there is a fluid distribution moving towards a wall and it impacts a wall at some position xp, then depending on the fluid, the velocity of the wall at that point, which I have written as ub, we could write the force experienced or exerted on the solid at this point in terms of the distributions post collision that move from the fluid side and the solid side towards this boundary node. So notice that, as I said, in this case xf is a fluid node, xs is a node which is inside the solid, which we said for making this calculation simpler, we said that this could be inside the, or there could be fluid inside the solid. So we could write the force at point xb at t plus half delta t in terms of f alpha star, which is at point xf. So it is a distribution moving in this direction towards a solid, minus f alpha bar, which is the distribution moving in the opposite direction of c alpha, but at xf plus c alpha delta t, which means it's this position xs, of course post collision, minus a component which happens because of momentum exchange. So what I'm going to introduce today is a simple problem which could be used to validate this force equation. So the model or the problem, test problem that we will solve is called as a Stokes' first problem. Some of you may have seen this in fluid mechanics, but let me just quickly introduce this problem. So the problem goes something like this, that we have a wall which is infinitely long. We can define the coordinate system for this wall. So let's say we have y here and x here, so the coordinate is y0 on the wall. So the plate initially is at rest, there's a fluid on the other side of the wall, so this side is all fluid. And what happens is that till time t0, the plate is stationary, so the fluid over the plate is also stationary. And then suddenly at time t0 plus, which means that right after time t0, we start pulling the plate or the wall towards the right at a constant velocity. So this is a case of an impulsively started flat plate. And the change that we're giving is, if I write the velocity, let's say the horizontal component, uy0, t, so at the boundary, which is y0, then this is 0 for t equal to 0 minus, and right at t greater than 0, we have a constant velocity u. And the idea is to find the flow field generated by the movement of this infinitely long plate. Now, since the plate is infinitely long, one of the first things that we can say about is that the gradients in the x direction of any function will be zero. Okay, which means, and of course, one of the things that I also assume here is that the fluid is incompressible. So density is constant throughout, which means that if I use continuity equation, and since I said d by dx is 0, we will have dv dy to be 0. Now this will basically give me the velocity v is 0 for all positions. And the reason being that dv dy is 0 would mean that the velocity is independent of x, but we also know that the velocity v is 0 on the plate. So it is 0 on the plate, so that means that everywhere it is actually 0. Okay, that is the only solution. Clearly, if v is 0 and u is, as I said, du dx is 0, u will only be a function of y and time. And this is basically a transient problem. So we want to look at the response of the fluid as the plate starts to be pulled. Now, if I look at the y momentum equation, we can write it as rho dv dt plus u dv dx plus v dv dy is minus dp dy plus mu d2v dx square plus d2v dy square, where mu is the dynamic viscosity of the fluid. Now, since v is 0, we have already proved that, and then the flow is steady, I can get rid of some quantities here. So this goes to 0. We said v is 0, so this is 0. This also goes to 0. So is this, and so is this. So the only thing that we are left with is dp dy is 0, which implies that p is only a function of x. Now let's look at the x momentum equation. In the x momentum equation, we'll have rho du dt u du dx v du dy is minus dp dx plus mu d2u dx square plus d2u dy square. So since we've already said flow is steady, so this is 0. We said du dx is 0, so this term goes to 0. V is 0, so this is 0. Du or d by dx of any quantity is 0, so that goes to 0. So what we are left with is an interesting equation in itself. We have du dt to be minus 1 by rho dp dx plus mu d2u dy square. And now if you look carefully, and since I mentioned here that p is only a function of x, that means this differential I can change to dp dx. Now the interesting thing to observe is the left hand side is only a function of y and t. This term will also be a function of y and t, because u is essentially a function of y and t. But what about the pressure gradient? Now this is a function of x, okay, which implies that the only way this equation can be written, or is physically possible, is if dp dx is 0, which implies p is a constant in this flow field. Okay, so this then gives us the final equation that we need to solve for the Stokes' first problem, which would be du dt is nu d2u dy square. So that is our governing equation with some boundary conditions. So let's look at the boundary condition as well. The first boundary condition is on the surface of the plate, the velocity is uw for all time t greater than 0. So we can write u 0 comma t is uw. The second boundary condition comes in that if I look at the domain now, when I start moving the plate to the right, far, far away, let's say at infinity, y going to infinity, the signal would still not be received. So the fluid far away will not sense that the plate has actually started moving. So far away, the velocity state will still be the same as the initial, what prevailed initially at time t0. So we can write u y going to infinity comma t will still be 0. And then we also have an initial condition for the problem. The initial condition is u y at time t0 is 0. Now to solve this problem, you will see in textbooks that a similarity variable approach is used, and I will not go into the details of deriving the similarity variable here, except I will say that if we use a similarity variable eta, which is y by 2 square root nu t, then we can prove that this equation which I am saying equation 1, we can prove that equation, this PD, because it's an equation in y and t now, can be converted into an ODE of the form d2f d eta square is minus 2 eta df d eta, where f of eta is actually the non-dimensionalized velocity. And then it's very easy to solve this differential equation, and the solution of this equation with the transformed boundary conditions, because now with similarity variable, two of the boundary conditions, in fact, the initial condition, right? So let me say this here, these two conditions will actually go into one boundary condition in eta, okay, which would basically be that as eta goes to infinity, u eta going to infinity will go to zero. So if you transform the boundary conditions, and of course the first boundary condition also change, this will turn out into, we'll have, when eta is equal to zero, we'll have f of zero to be equal to one. So the solution to this problem will actually come out to be u y comma t by u wall is 1 minus error function of y by 2 square root nu t, which becomes, can also be written as a complementary error function, so ERFC, the complementary error function of y by 2 square root nu t. And the way the solution would look like pictorially would be that if we plot, let's say, y coordinate versus u by uw, and let's say we have a value 1 here, then very early on, just when you start moving the plate, right, the velocity field would be something like this. So let's say this is at some time t1, at some time t2 after that, we'll have a velocity field which would be something like that, and then t3 would be something like that, and then maybe I can draw one more, t4, which would go like that. So that would be the solution where the time instance, now if I have to write, t1 would be less than t2, would be less than t3, would be less than t4. So the momentum is going to diffuse to a greater depth as time goes on. Now the reason I'm choosing this problem here to demonstrate or to encourage you to try and, you know, work out the solution to this problem using LBM is because there is a closed form solution for the force experienced by the plate as a function of time. So we may calculate the shear force exerted on the plate, which would be, let's say, tau at y0, which would basically be, of course, mu du dy at y0. So if you calculate this, that will come out to be minus mu uw by square root pi nu to t. So time, so square, it goes as inverse square root of time. So the force will actually be substantially large initially, but then it would decrease as time goes on. So what we can do in this problem is to verify whether the total force experienced by the plate of a given length, let's say we choose a length L in this problem, or let me draw a schematic and then maybe explain, that would be maybe make more sense. So let's say in LBM I choose a domain of this type, that let's say I take some kind of a rectangular domain, okay, and I can say that the bottom surface is the wall. So this is my wall, and I discretize, you know, I take some height h of this body or this domain, and the wall is moving at velocity uw, and I try and solve this problem using LBN. So what basically I will have are, for instance, some nodes in the solid, and I will have fluid nodes in the fluid. So I can maybe denote them by this color. So depending on the length that I choose, the total force on the plate, or the total force that the fluid will, or the, you know, the shearing force that you will experience to keep pulling the plate at this constant velocity uw, should actually be tau that we computed into the length into a unit depth. So that should be the force along x. So this is what we can verify using LBM. We can calculate the total force using, by summing up on all boundary nodes, as we have as I discussed in the earlier lecture, and that could be then validated against the analytical solution, because analytical solution, in the analytical solution we already have the shear stress, so multiplying that by L basically gives us the total force. So to model this problem, now a few things would need to be done. So one thing that we need to do is work, so the lower wall is a boundary, and so we know the bounce back will have to be applied on this wall, but what about the other three boundaries? So as I said, along the x direction, remember this is x and this is y, along the x direction, the two boundaries, these two boundaries are actually, you know, or rather the plate I said is infinitely long. So these two essentially should mimic periodic boundaries. So we can apply periodic boundary conditions on these two boundaries. So any distribution which is leaving, let's say, should essentially enter from the other side, and same will go for the left side, this boundary. Now what about the far field condition? Now this is something which is going to be interesting, and this is where a little bit of insight and a little bit of back of the envelope calculation will have to be done. So we need to, in deriving the analytical solution, we assume that the far boundary has no shear. Remember we said it's far, far away, where the velocity field has not changed. So we don't say it's zero velocity. At some point it will actually have, and this is a finite domain, so at some point it will actually see some velocity. So what we do is we can impose the free slip boundary condition here. And by that what I mean is we'll have specular bounce back, right? So we'll have specular bounce back, but this will only be true until the fluid, you know, has transmitted that information to the wall or to the top boundary. Now the time scale in which the movement of the fluid or the movement of the plate will be felt by the top surface or the specular boundary can be written in terms of the height and the kinematic viscosity. So we can say that this would be the time scale for the momentum to diffuse to the top boundary. So our simulation time scale, or the number of time steps that we can run this simulation to, will be basically dependent on this number. It would be some multiple, or some, you know, would be the same order of this time scale. So for instance, if the height is, let's say 100 lattices, and let's say we take the kinematic viscosity to be, or rather let's say the relaxation time to be maybe 0.8, which means that the kinematic viscosity then becomes 0.1, yeah, 0.1 in lattice units. So that would mean that the time scale for the problem would be 100 square, which becomes 10 to the power 4 by 0.1. So this is about 10 to the power 5 time steps. Right? But if I take a smaller domain, let's say if I take, this is first, let me take a second scenario. Let's say that height is taken to be only 10 lattices or 10 lattice height and tau is still 0.8. So then the time scale would be 100 by 0.1. So that goes to be about 1000 delta t or 1000 time steps. So this will determine the time scale to which a simulation can be run to verify this finding. So this is a problem that I would expect any student of lattice Boltzmann method to be able to solve and verify, because this is a simple illustration. The other aspect that I would also mention here, which is a sort of like a also a critical point, is that in the force calculation that you have seen, which is here, in the force calculation we need distributions on either side of the boundary. So we need F alpha, which is on the fluid side, but we also have F alpha bar, which is on the fluid side. Now when we solve a problem of this type, so on this end, on the solid side, right, we are not solving anything, but we need that distribution to be able to calculate the force. Now the force calculation can actually be done, or the complete force calculation on the face of this moving boundary can be done in this case by assuming one simple idea. What we can assume is that the fluid on the other side, which is on the solid side, the fictitious fluid, okay, this fluid on the other side can be assumed to be moving uniformly at a constant velocity, which is the same as the velocity of the moving wall. So I can say this is uw. And it would therefore exert no force on the wall, because remember the reflection will not change the distribution anyway, because if the fluid is moving at the same velocity as the wall, that would basically mean that there can be no momentum exchange between the two layers. And so in that in the force calculation that I had shown or I had written earlier in as part of this at the starting of this lecture, so what I can now do is that I can replace this distribution that appears on the solid side, I can replace this with the equilibrium distribution corresponding to some reference density and the moving wall velocity. And replacing it here would just be right in calculating this force. So this assumption will actually help us in closing the problem and getting a solution. So I leave the lecture here. I would end the lecture here, and I would encourage you to try it out and work out the steps for yourself. All the tools have been already discussed in the earlier lectures, and verify that the force comes out to be exactly as what is given by the analytical solution. Okay, so thank you for listening, and see you next time.